Welcome to another episode of The Brand Called You, a video and podcast show that brings you leadership lessons, knowledge, experience, and wisdom from hundreds of successful individuals from around the world. Today, it is my privilege to welcome a very, very accomplished individual, Meera Shenoy, to our show. Meera, welcome to the show.
Thank you.
The founder of Youth for Jobs, which is really for mainstreaming youth with disabilities and the workplace. She set up the Employment Generation and Marketing Mission in Telangana, which is EGMM. She's the founder of Not Just Art, which showcases work of artists with disabilities. She's the author of a book called You Can, and she's a national award winner of Empowerment of Disability from the President of India. So Meera, tell me, what would you say are three key milestones in your life or your career?
I think making choices. I used to be a business journalist and a TV journalist and decided to make a move to the social sector.
Okay.
Then when you move to the social sector, your choices are so wide in a country like India. Mm-hmm. So deciding to work with underprivileged youth and now vulnerable youth, mm-hmm. because Ashutosh, if you catch them at that young age, you can influence 50 years of their lives.
Correct.
Okay. And then again, a choice of, so if you want to transform their lives, what is the path you use? Which are multiple paths. There again, I made the choice that I will skill them and link them to jobs. Because a job allows me to transform their lives and the lives of the most vulnerable in a short period of time.
And what else, talk to me a little bit about maybe a milestone in journalism and maybe a milestone in writing your book.
Writing the book was, I think it was a part of my journey of being a change maker. Because when I decided to enter the world of disability, I didn't realize what a complex world it was.
Correct.
We had problems in every area. The youth were not enrolling into our training centers. I had decided that we should work with a real India, which no one was doing, which meant youth with disabilities with less education from the villages and tier two towns. What I didn't realize was that even in villages, the mindsets were so deep, so there were no youth enrolling. Disability is one word, there are multiple disabilities. Companies had a network, they came, but they looked at it and said, ma'am, can you give me some of the youth who looked, like the work you did before? So I just wondered, had I taken on too much and then said, okay, one way to energize my own batteries is to go around the country and talk to youth with disabilities who've been successful in their careers or as entrepreneurs. And secondly, is to talk to chairmen and CEOs who integrated business and disability or business and compassion.
Okay.
So this became a book. I did it actually with Prasad Kaipa, who was a co-author. He used to come to Hyderabad to lecture at ISB and is a wonderful soul. We both are good friends.
Okay.
And this was amazing when I did the book, right from Kasturi Rangan to Kamath of BRICS Bank. I just WhatsApp them saying, listen, will you give me a line saying this book is interesting? And all of them did. It was a Bloomsbury publication. It got launched with no effort at the Jaipur Literary Festival. Went on to have an Hindi edition because the grassroots wanted to read it. It's in the third edition. The wonderful thing is that about it is that the message to me was that if all of them could do it despite their challenges, definitely I can. So the message to the readers was then that definitely you can. Don't give up your path. Don't give up your passion.
Very interesting. So let's talk about, the organization you created, which is Youth for Jobs. Tell me about the kind of work you do.
So the vision is that every youth with disabilities should have access to education and employment opportunities. I think that it's been like a journey and the work has evolved, keeping one eye on the community and one eye on the markets. So we began by being pioneers in the space of setting up training centers for youth with disabilities with less education who come from rural areas and tier two towns, mm-hmm. training them and putting them into jobs.
Mm.
Then we realized that companies have deep mindsets, so you have to work deeply with companies. So we set up a division called Company Connect, which works mm-hmm. with companies to give them a whole range of services. Now, as we started working with companies and MNCs, mm-hmm. they asked me, Meera, hey, where are the educated youth? And we were not working with the educated youth, Ashutosh, because mm-hmm. I really believe that if you're educated, you don't need us, okay? Mm. I need to only work with the less educated.
Correct.
But then I did some pilots. I'm amazed that the issue is the same, because in India, you only look at the disability. You do not look at other things, you know? So we started a College Connect program mm-hmm. where now we set up something called Smart Inclusion Centers mm-hmm. in colleges.
Right.
To become a system changer. So the vision of Youth for Jobs is to be a system changer, because that's the only way you can take them out of from the vicious cycle of poverty, and studies mm-hmm. show that. Mm-hmm. So you need to move them to the virtuous cycle of opportunity.
Okay.
So that's what Youth for Jobs does in a nutshell.
And what are the kind of challenges you face when you know you're looking for suitable jobs for these youth?
Oh, I think there are myriads of challenges. Mm-hmm. The biggest challenge in all these areas, whether it's in the community, whether it's the company, or whether it's in colleges, the three C's, mm-hmm. it's all mindset, mindset, mindset.
Okay.
In India, especially for the companies, you can't blame them, because first is that all of them in schools, they are not inclusive. Mm-hmm. Secondly, so the roads, our roads and public transport is not accessible. So obviously the companies don't understand disabilities, and you need to take them on this journey of inclusion. Mm-hmm. And also what is important is you need to show them that actually it helps your business, because ultimately for companies, the bottom line is important. So how do you demonstrate this? So we have a whole range of services which we do with companies, mm-hmm. right from sensitization workshops for the board to the supervisors, showing them jobs, which disability can go into what job, workplace adaptation, technology mm-hmm. synchronizing. So there's a whole range of disabilities which we take them through. That's okay. one level. The second very important level, Ashutosh, is that how do you put them into customer-facing jobs and not mm-hmm. hide them at the back? Because it's only then the society also gets sensitized.
Right.
And we've done some lovely work in that area too.
Okay. And, you know, when you say you get a, you know, group of individuals, you train them, how do you determine what skills to give to which individual?
Yeah. So what we do is, of course, for the different disabilities, you need to have different processes and mediums. For example, mm-hmm. maybe at least 40% of the youth whom we train are speech and hearing impaired. Mm-hmm. So for them, you need to teach them with sign language. So mm-hmm. we have sign language, video sign language instructors for them. And for the visually impaired, they need to be first taught this JAWS technology, which is a talking software, so that anything on the screen can be spoken out aloud, and that opens out the whole world of knowledge to them, which was not there before because they didn't understand technology.
Correct.
So these differences are there in disability, but what we train them in is we give them what we call 21st century portable skills.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. We teach them all what they lacked before, like foundation skills, English, communication, life skills, soft skills, orientation to the job market, to jobs which we've mapped. So, for example, if he's getting into retail, then, you know, orientation to retail. And of course, for the educated, our focus is basically two large sectors. Our focus is IT and the banking and financial mm-hmm. sector. So there it's very, very focused. After the foundation, we move on to the higher level.
Okay. And, you know, you did mention that, you know, when organizations want to employ them, you said that it's understandable. My question to you is that what is your experience in making sure there is an environment of inclusion for all the young people coming out of your training programs?
Yeah, that's right. So any new company which comes to us, unless they go through a sensitization workshop mm-hmm. where it's, you know, before I used to think it's enough if the board is sensitized, okay, mm-hmm. the CEO is sensitized. But very soon we realized, by Jove, that's not enough. Actually, what you have correct. To do is the immediate supervisor or the manager who's working, you know, you need to make sure that they are sensitized, because they are the ones who are going to work every day, you know. Correct. And I'll tell you, these processes have to be hardwired in organizations. And what we have typically started doing is that we get one from the organization who we empower with these skills so mm-hmm. that we don't need to keep doing it all the time. He becomes mm-hmm. like a mentor. We have lovely case studies. I must tell you this one. There's this company called Valeo. It's a French company. Okay. Mm-hmm. So the CEO called me and he said, Meera, I hear this is the work you're doing. Can you give me a receptionist? Mm-hmm. Okay. I said, no, let me not. Let's put, you know, a couple of speech and hearing impaired kids. Mm-hmm. It's manufacturing, assembling. So it's a good opportunity mm-hmm. for us. So when they all got, and we hardwired all processes, did workplace adaptations, and most of these are low cost and simple. Like, mm-hmm. you know, for example, you worry about evacuation, safety procedures. Instead mm-hmm. of a sound, you put a light. Okay. Simple processes like that can be put in at low cost.
Right.
So when he saw all this and he heard the parents speak of the importance of a job, mm-hmm. Jay told me, hey, Meera, you know, this work is going to give me such good karma. So I told him, listen, please don't think it's good karma alone. Okay. Correct. Just wait. And 3 months later, when they did, you know, when they measured the impact of our work, mm-hmm. they found that both attrition and productivity, it was really tremendous. Mm-hmm. And that division, which we began our work with, they shared it with the other HR. Mm-hmm. And not just that, as the managers kept moving to other plants, they kept looking at us. Mm-hmm. And France, where they're headquartered, ran an award for the first time for all the 3,600 plants. Mm-hmm. And our work won the award.
Amazing. Wow. So, congratulations.
Yeah, so we have nice stories, you know, which give us great joy.
Fabulous. Fabulous. Well, maybe there's a new book coming out on all the fantastic stories that you can narrate about all the experiences. But let's talk, Meera, about now EGMM, the Employment Generation and Marketing Mission in Telangana. Tell me, what got you involved in this and what were some of your successes and your challenges?
Yeah, it's not a mission of Telangana. AP and Telangana used to be joined together. Mm-hmm. So it's actually Andhra Pradesh. And it's the first skilling mission of the country. Mm-hmm. I think the state is pretty progressive, okay? And the government officers. So they realized when I was hired to do a component in the World Bank called Private Sector Partnerships with the Poor. So I was sort of doing various models, and one which I was doing was, it was very clear that the aspirations of the youth, Ashutosh, mm-hmm. are completely different from the aspirations of their parents. No weaver son wants to be a weaver, or a farmer sure. son wants to be a farmer, because mm-hmm. he sees the toil of his father. So what I did was, using my private sector background, I did a small thing which I called Rural Retail Academy in Warangal, okay, mm-hmm. where I took school teachers, made them look at malls. At that time, beyond Kishoreji's malls were up everywhere. Mm-hmm. Reliance was saying they'll enter. Mm-hmm. So I set it up, and we took, you know, youth who just finished their school and ran it. And then it shows amazing results, okay? And then Rama Bijapurkar wrote it in the Economic Times, saying that this is the future. If anyone wants to see it, go and look at it. So then there was really no looking back for me. In government, if you do well, they just pour money on you, you know? So from 1 crore to 300 crores, I took the mission.
Wow.
I learned many lessons, as you asked. One is that you can leverage your previous networks for doing good. Mm. Okay. Second is that you have to be bloody smart if you're sitting in the government, because there'll be 20 people who will tell you that your idea will not work. Mm-hmm. Okay.
Correct.
And that they've tried it out before. You know, yeah. you feel like saying, hey, why not? But I'd like to try it too. But you have to quietly say, yes, and try it on your own. Mm. Third is that when the government adopts your work, they adopt it wholeheartedly. Correct. And they take it to the next level. Okay. Mm. So my young team, I had a very small 3 people working with me from the private sector as a core, okay, assisting me. Mm-hmm. They just couldn't understand. Here was the same government guy who wouldn't support you in any way. And now, you know, he's just telling your same language back to you. And they used to say, you know, what is this? And I say, listen, please understand. That means he's fully absorbed your work. And there can be nothing more beautiful than
fantastic.
That.
Fantastic. Fantastic. So tell me, you know, the kind of work that you are doing now, how has that impacted, or the other way, how has COVID impacted the amount of work that you are doing?
I must tell you, Ashutosh, that COVID has been an amazing time for us to reflect and reboot, you mm-hmm. know. Every youth, when we had to close our residential training centers, told us that in these times, please do not stop your work, because they knew what the situation back home was mm-hmm. with their parents. All of them will lose their marginal incomes, which they get. Right. So we said, now what to do? How do we continue our program? But we decided boldly we'll go online. Mm-hmm. Having gone online, we did it with taking our stakeholders on board. For everything, we asked the youth and the companies, mm-hmm. how many hours, what is good, how do you prevent dropouts, how will assessments be done? So therefore, what happened was that when we actually launched it, it worked very well. But even we were not prepared for the kind of desire there's in the poor to be digitally savvy, you know, in isolation times. It was tremendous. There were more girls with disabilities logging in from the safety of their home. They have tiny houses. So mothers would wonder, why is this youth hanging on to this, right. you know, phone all the time? So they would come on and my trainer would explain what is happening. And mothers became our word of mouth ambassadors for wow. this. Okay. We heard stories from the youth of the kind of impact which is happening in the villages through their voices, you know. Mm. And many of them are becoming role models for the villages because their incomes are more than what a non-disabled youth is getting since we are there to support them. And so I think we have really inspired. In fact, UNICEF chose us as one of the best practices of wow. COVID times for South Asia wow. in this space. So it's been a good feeling of having bet COVID, you know, and taken our work all across the country, including Kashmir.
Wow, fantastic. So I'm now going to move to the last segment of our conversation, which is some questions for you personally. Mm-hmm. My first question to you, Meera, is, you know, you're doing so much for such an amazing community of people. What does giving mean to you?
I think, of course, my definition of giving is also broad. It's not just money. And sure. I think no one should wait to give.
Correct.
Having said that, and while personally I've also promised the LNP, which you know about, mm-hmm. I think what obsesses me, yes, it's an obsession, is the giving of the poor. Mm. It began by looking, you know, at trends of what our alumni are doing, mm-hmm. those especially who come from the villages. There was this youth who, you know, he just blew my mind when he was telling me he had an accident, he lost his job, we retooled him, we put him into a gaming company. Mm-hmm. And when he saw me 2 years later, he sort of stretched his arms and told me how much money he has. Okay. So I said, okay, if you have that much money, what do you do with it? So he told me he saves, he sends it back home. But then he told me, he said, you know, because I still think I have more, Ashutosh, the spirit of abundance, which he has, he said, now, you know, I'm distributing chalk, slates for people in my village who can't wow. afford it. Mm. And that really set me thinking. And so we started doing surveys with our alumni to see what is the spirit of giving they have. Mm-hmm. And it was amazing for me. It was really amazing. So now what I'm doing is I'm setting up an alumni network, and we have 25,300 of them. Okay. Wow. Mm-hmm. An alumni network. I'm saying if the IIMs and the IITs have one, why can't my youth have one? Yeah. And can we mentor the spirit of giving so that this whole space of disability, which is voiceless, can we make these voices come up from the village? Because finally, that's the real India, Ashutosh, if you need to bring significant sustained change in this space.
Okay. And therefore, you know, my automatic next question to you is that what does success mean to Meera?
That's actually a really interesting question. I think success for me is that am I able to shift the focus onto the others? Mm-hmm. Okay. When you look at a telescope, and recently I think all of us did it, you realize, you know, what a small dot the Earth is. And then, you know, then you tell yourself what a smaller dot you are. Okay. Yep. Mm-hmm. But how do you keep this awareness alive? Okay. The fact that that's the way, and not put yourself in the center of the world. Mm-hmm. I think that's, to me, important. Yeah. And if I do that, then I'm successful. And what that does to you is, I think that I know that with certainty that in a small and a sure way, I'll leave behind a better India and a better world. And that allows me to sleep peacefully without any medicines or anything, and to get up with a spring in my feet, however Fantastic. Much I can spring.
Fantastic. And my last question to you, it comes to the subject of failure. I've often said that in India or South Asia or Asia, parents don't teach their children it's okay to fail. Yeah. We've all been taught first aana hai, be at the head of the line. And that manifests itself in our behavior patterns later. Yet we keep on failing and we keep learning. The question to Meera is, what have been some of your learnings from some of your mistakes or your failures?
When I reflect back, I think certainly one failure is that, and which I've overcome, is let me begin with personal first, okay? The personal failure is, I think, expecting I have only one daughter, to live a certain kind of life. Okay, let me say that. Because the way I used to think of it, Ashutosh, is I don't have fancy degrees. Okay, but she's from the London School, she's from undergrad in the US, she's from Rishi Valley, she's got all the best ingredients in her, and was all poised to do certain things. Okay, but then she wrote this book on the Arvind Eye Care Infinite Vision, okay? So she decided to give up hers. And now, basically, she's more like a very, very, very Buddhist person who lives minimalistically, okay? And of course, she does financial investments, but I think that overcome is what is most important to her. So it took me some time, I think, and I think that's my failure, because when I look back, and so obviously there's a bit of anguish and pain, and I tell myself how silly, you know, now when I look back. But yes, that's my failure. I think parents expect, you know, certain things from the kids which you should not do. Okay.
Correct.
In work life, yes, I think you do make failures, and I've made failures even in my pilots which I've done. Okay. But I think the good thing is that you quickly move. For example, many times you know these ideas, but when you actually work, you don't necessarily put them into action. For example, in my first pilot, the Rural Retail Academy, a large company came and said they'll take all the youth. So I said, okay. And I just waited, and they didn't tell me their business plans had changed. And so my costs were going up, the youth were not taken. And the government was stressing me because it was my first pilot.
Correct.
And I think it was really, and then I thought to myself, I mean, all I did was then I sent a mail to Kishore Ji, whom I didn't know. I said, see, here I'm doing this pilot in rural India. The company who said they'll come and take haven't taken. I'm sitting in the government, a private sector person. Can you please support me, because you have so many malls? And you won't imagine, Ashutosh, within minutes, I got a call from his HR. The HR came, the whole batch was taken, and there was, for me, no looking back. Wow. But the lesson I knew that don't depend on one customer. Mm-hmm. Okay. But I didn't learn that lesson. You see, I had to make that mistake and never again after that did I make the mistake. But having said that, I must tell you, Ashutosh, that I really give, I believe tremendously in people. So I let my team, I really believe in them. I let them make mistakes. I give them a long rope. People wonder why. Mm. But I feel from failures like what you say, what will emerge is that today what you see in Youth for Jobs is 150 flowers blossoming. Mm. And that's the only way this work can blossom. Right.
Absolutely. Well said. Meera, thank you so much. It's been such a pleasure speaking to you. I wish you lots of success in everything you do.
Thank you, Ashutosh.
Thank you.
Thank you for listening to the brand called You Videocast and Podcast, a platform that brings you knowledge, experience, and wisdom of hundreds of successful individuals from around the world. Do visit our website www.tbcy.in to watch and listen to the stories of many more individuals. You can also follow us on YouTube, Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter. Just search for the brand called You.